وإن تعجب فعجب قولهم أإذا كنا ترابا أإنا لفي خلق جديد أولئك الذين كفروا بربهم وأولئك الأغلال في أعناقهم وأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Welcome to another Hot Seat Q&A session where we're going to be answering questions on episode 6 of the Hot Seat. Was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam a false prophet? We've got a number of questions that have been sent into our email address, questions@thehotseatpodcast.com, and I've got 5 in total that we're going to go through today. So without further ado, let's get straight into it, inshallah. Ustad, the first question I have for you is regarding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's marriage to his wife Aisha. Now, this is a common issue that comes up a number of times by a number of people. A lot of people question the, number one, the authenticity, and number two, the acceptability of the Prophet ﷺ's marriage to Aisha at such a young age. So I have two questions. Number one, is it authentic? And number two, how do we understand this in the modern world, considering it seems to many to be a strange thing?
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. As for the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم marrying Aisha at the age of 9, that is ثابت, is authentically transmitted. It's not something we should shy away from, it's the truth. The Prophet ﷺ married Aisha at the age of 9. And that is sahih through many ahadiths. A person who hasn't smelled the fragrance of knowledge of hadith is one who would say that that's not the case.
Is it marriage at the age of 9 or marriage at the age of 6 and consummating the marriage at the age of 9?
In other words, the Prophet ﷺ, his dukhul to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, may Allah be pleased with her and her father, was when she was 9 years of age. Before her, he married Sauda bint Zam'a, who was divorced, and then he married her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha was in a bi'ah, an environment, where if you look at the Arabian Peninsula, even recently, you would see people whose ages were very young, but were very mature. Because of the heat, the lifestyle, those people were not your ordinary 9-year-old that you would see. Even now, if you go to some places in my country, you would see the 9-year-old is healthier and more, you know, well aged compared to the normal 9-year-old that you would see. Plus, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he married Aisha for wisdoms. Number one, in that he saw sallallahu alaihi wasallam, annahu ra'a ru'ya, he saw a dream where he was marrying her. Hadith Sahih al-Bukhari. The second thing is that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he saw from her amarat, signs, and that showed her the cat, how smart she was and how clever she was, radiallahu ta'ala anha. And the third one was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam had great love for her father. The Messenger had great love for her father, Abu Bakr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. If you look at the Prophet's biography, you would see that the overwhelm, or all of his wives that he married, they were widows, divorcees. The only woman he married that was a virgin was Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So they make it look like that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Aisha because of desires and whatnot. But these are the wisdoms why he married her sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And again, to use a timing where and has taken it out of the timing and the surrounding that it was in is also incorrect. The enemies of Al-Islam at that time, Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Sanadid Quraysh, if they could find any way to slander the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to belittle him, to put him down, they would use it. And they never brought this against him alayhi salatu wasalam. So it wasn't something specific to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it was something through the Arabian Peninsula that was practiced. Again, I mentioned the explanation of taking into context the land and the environment that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha got married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Naam.
Jazakallah khairan. The second question I have for you again is relating to one of the marriages of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some people who reject the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a true prophet from Allah claim that he was a warlord, and they use a particular story to do with Kinanah ibn Rabi', and they talk about his marriage to Safiya, and they bring this context of the story where Kinanah was a Jewish man who was looking after the treasure of Banu Nadir, and the Prophet wanted to find out where the treasure was. He interrogated Kinanah, he then killed Kinanah, and then proceeded to marry his widowed wife Safiya. This is an issue that many people say, that how could a true prophet from God do this?
First of all, we have to understand is this story of Kinanah ibn Rabi' is transmitted in two books of the Seerah. The first one is Tariq al-Tabari, and the second book is the Ibn Hisham's Tabaqat. Ibn Hisham also mentions it. The scholars, they mention that books of Seerah, they consist and they contain in it a hadith which are weak, a hadith which are sahih, and a hadith which are fabricated. ولذلك عراقي, he says in his Alfiyat al-Seerah, he says, وَلْيَعْلَمِ الطَّالِبُ أَنَّ السِّيرَ تَجْتَمِعُ وَلْيَعْلَمِ الطَّالِبُ أَنَّ السِّيرَ تَجْمَعُ مَا صَحَّ وَمَا قَدْ أَنْكَرَ أَمَا وَلْيَعْلَمِ الطَّالِبُ أَنَّ السِّيرَ تَجْمَعُ مَا قَدْ صَحَّ وَمَا قَدْ أُنْكِرَ. Like, the student of knowledge needs to know that the books of the Seerah, they have in them that which is authentic, مَا صَحَّ, that which is sahih, and also مَا قَدْ أُنْكِرَ, that which has been rejected. So let's use the science of hadith and apply it here. لأن the conditions of authenticity is five, right? وأول, the poet, he said, وأهل هذا الشأن قسموا السنن إلى صحيح وضعيف وحسن. فالأول المتصل الإسناد من غير فالأول المتصل الإسناد بنقل عدل ضابط الفؤاد من غير ما شذوذ وعلة قادحة فتوذي. Five conditions of authenticity. So the chain of narration has to be connected. The people in the chain have to be all authentic in terms of their integrity. The memorization of the narrator has to be upright. It cannot be opposing any other narration. There can't be any hidden defects in the hadith. So let's check if it meets those five conditions that I mentioned. Let's go through the story in where it's narrated in the book of Al-Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's Tariq. In the chain of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's chain, there's a man by the name of Muhammad Ibn al-Humayd al-Raziyu. Muhammad ibn al-Humayd al-Razi. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said, وَهُوَ مَعَ إِمَامَتِي, even though this man is considered to be an imam, مُنْكَرُ الْحَدِيثِ صَاحِبُ عَجَائِبُ. His hadiths are munkar, rejected, and he is a man who comes with fascination. Bukhari said, فِي حَدِيثِهِ نَظَر. And Al-Imam al-Bukhari doesn't like criticizing people. He used to stay away from slandering or criticizing people. So if Al-Imam al-Bukhari says this person's hadith is nadar, it's one of his strongest forms of saying that this hadith is very weak. Rather, Abu Zur'ah and Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Wara, they both said, وَصَحَ عِنْدَنَا أَنَّهُ يَكْذِبُ. It's actually authentically transmitted that he lies. Okay, so that's the first book it's narrated in. The second book is the Tabaqat of Ibn Sa'ad. Then this is also weak for two reasons. The first reason is that there's a man by the name of Muhammad ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Laylat al-Ansari, and he's weak. Hafidh ibn Hajr, he said about him, Suduqun sayyul hifdh jidda. He's got a very bad memory and he does many mistakes. The second problem that it has also is Ibn Ishaq. Okay, Ibn Ishaq, he died the year 150 Hijriah and was born in the 80th. And he's the one who transmitted this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in other words, there's two disconnections in the chain. Two people are missing. And we know in Ilm al-Hadith, if two people are missing, this is considered to be weak because it's disconnection, right? It's called mu'dal. وَمُعْضَلُ سَاقِطُ مِنْهُ اثْنَانِ وَمَا أَتَى مُدَلَّسَ النَّوْعَانِ. It's mu'dal. Two people are missing. Ibn Ishaq, between him and the Prophet, are two people. So this hadith is weak. A third point that I want to mention is that even if we say the hadith is sahih, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if we say, which is not the case, but for the sake of argument, Kinanah ibn al-Rabi' was killed qisasan, based on the story itself, the way it's transmitted. He was killed because he killed who? Muhammad ibn Maslamah. So it's not even what they make it look like, even if we take it authentic now.
Okay, the third question I have for you is regarding the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's death. There were some ayat at the end of Surah Al-Haqa. وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بَعْضَ الْأَقَوِيلَ أَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينَ ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينَ. Loosely translated as, if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was to invent a lie against Allah, then Allah would seize him by his right hand and cut off his aorta. And there's a hadith that some people bring in Sahih al-Bukhari, which says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his ailment in which he died, used to say, "O Aisha, I still feel the pain caused by the food I ate at Khaybar. And at this time, I feel as if my aorta is being cut from that poison." So some people say that this proves that he was a false prophet, because Allah says in the Quran that he would cut his aorta if he was a false prophet. And that is exactly what happened. What is the response for this?
Couple of responses. Number one is, the ayah and the hadith mentioned two different wordings. If we're fair, the ayah that you brought, it says, وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بَعْضَ الْأَقَاوِيلَ لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينَ ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينَ. And in the hadith of Aisha that you mentioned, he said, يَا عَائِشَ مَا أَجِدُ أَلَمَ الطَّعَامِ يَا عَائِشَةُ مَا أَزَالُ أَجِدُ أَلَمَ الطَّعَامِ الَّذِي أَكَلْتُ بِخَيْبَرَ فَهَذَا أَوَانُ وَجَدْتُ إِنْقِطَاعَ إِبْهَرِي. He said, Aisha, I can find the kind of the إِبْهَرِي. إِبْهَرِي is different from the word وَتِين. But even if we accept the translation to be iota for both of them, then let's take a couple of things on board. Number one, this happened, the poisoning of the Prophet ﷺ, it happened on the 7th year of the Hijriya. Yawm Khaybar was on the 7th. Ibn Abi al-Izz al-Hanafi, he says, وَفَرْضُ الْحَجِّ بِخُلْفٍ فَاسْمَعْ وَكَانَ فَتْحُ خَيْبَرٍ فِي السَّابِعَةِ. The conquest of Khaybar was on the 7th year of the Hijriya. That's the call of the Jumhur al-Ulama. Some of them even transmitted a consensus. So 3 years after that, Prophet still lived. So how did Allah let him live for three years after that, if he was going to be destroyed if he lied about Allah Azza wa Jalla? Why is it his religion is still consistent? If Allah destroyed him, then he should have destroyed his message as well. That was what was intended to be done. So those are the points I think that needs to be taken on board. Also, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the story itself, it mentions that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he himself, he stopped eating the meat because he was informed of it. When the Jewish woman gave him the meat, the Prophet ﷺ was informed by the meat itself that it was poisonous and not to eat him. So I don't think this supports the doubt that's been pushed forward. And it's been used by someone who believes that the Sunnah is authentic. Does that person actually believe that the Sunnah is authentic?
Not the person I saw it from.
Because if the Sunnah that you're trying to use it from, then I can give you many other hadiths you should take.
Jazakallah khairan. Another question is, you mentioned in the podcast itself that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was illiterate, but we also know that he wrote many letters. How do you explain this?
This issue of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being illiterate is nusus al-wahyain. It's in the Quran, it's also in the Sunnah. Allah said, فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّيِّ الَّذِي يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَكَلِمَاتِهِ وَاتَّبِعُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. In another ayah, Allah said, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبَطِلُونَ. These two verses mention that the Prophet is illiterate, nor does he read or write. Some scholars, they used a hadith, which is found in Sahih al-Bukhari, the day of Hudaybiyah. The day of Hudaybiyah. It mentions in the wording of Imam al-Bukhari, فَأَخَذَ فأخذ فكتب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Something like that. The wording, I think it was like that. The meaning of the word that was used is فأخذ فكتب. فكتب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet took the pen and he wrote. And the scholar that used this evidence to say that the Prophet could write was Abu Walid al-Baji. Two great scholars responded to him, Ibn Kathir and Ibn Hajar. They said that this wording that you used, Abu al-Walid, why don't you use the other wording that has come, which is fa'amara? He commanded for it to be written and it was written. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not one to write and he wasn't one to read, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He was sallallahu alayhi wa sallam illiterate. The Quran mentions that. And in the Sunnah, there's no place to show that he could read or write. They also say that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on his last moment, he said to the companions, bring me something bring me a paper or something so I can write for you something that if you take on board, you will not be misguided after me. Scholars, they said he meant he again here, that he will make someone write for them. Because remember, you attribute an action to a leader, even if he doesn't build the country, you'll say he built the country. Even if he isn't the one who's physically doing it. So the Prophet, that's what he meant it from that angle, alayhi salatu wasalam. But these ayat are nas sarih, they're clear cut verses to show that the Prophet was not one to write.
So when he sent the letters to the different kings, he wasn't actually writing it, sorry, he wasn't actually writing it himself. He was commanding people to write it on his behalf.
No.
Perfect. The final question I have for you is, you also mentioned that one of the miracles that the Prophet ﷺ performed with the permission of Allah was to split the moon. Someone is asking, how could that be the case when many people across the world can see the moon and nobody recorded this event in history?
The qa'ida is man alima hujjatun ala man lam ya'lam. Just because you didn't see it doesn't mean it didn't happen. It doesn't exist. The one who knows is a proof against the one who doesn't know. So because those who saw it will take their words because they saw it, and the one who didn't see it could probably be sleeping, could probably doing something else. So we take the ones who affirm over the ones who don't say anything.
So there were witnesses that affirmed it?
Oh, his companions and his followers who saw it when he did it, alayhi salatu wasalam.
Perfect. Jazakallahu khairan. That's all of the questions I have for you today. Barakallahu feek for joining me once again. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.